Now let's take a look at the important difference between phonemic and allophonic variation in language. Now before we get into the difference between phonemes and allophones, let's take a second to understand an important concept, the concept of the minimal pair. A minimal pair is an instance where two words differ by only one sound, yet everyone who's a native speaker of the language hears those as two separate words. Now let me take a look and show you what that means. The words book and look are very similar. The middle sound and the final sound are exactly the same. Yet we hear them as different words, even though they have that one difference in sound at the beginning. Fit and fight are likewise heard by native speakers of English as different words. Now, don't worry about the fact that they're spelled differently. What's important is that there are three sounds in fit and three sounds in fight. And in spite of the fact that only the middle sound is different, we hear those as different words. The same with brook and broke, different words. Now, that can be contrasted with the sounds in the word later with a T sound, or later, with that sound that's almost like a D where your tongue just goes up and hits the ridge of bone behind your teeth. That's called a flap. Later and later. Now, we might hear those as different and recognize that people are pronouncing them differently, but we never get confused about what words they mean. We know that those are just two different ways to pronounce one word. But they are different sounds. Even though we don't recognize it easily, if we take the time, we can hear later, 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 and later as pronounced differently. We recognize that there's one sound different, but that's not a minimal pair because that one sound difference doesn't change the meaning of the word. Now, the same with two different pronunciations of fire and fire. My grandmother is from the South. Actually, I'm from the South as well, and I remember my grandmother talking to us when we were cooking outside one day, and I remember her screaming very clearly, "Kids, get away from the fire!" And she pronounces that word quite differently, fire and fire. Now, that's just one sound difference, but all native speakers still hear that as the same word. The same with two different pronunciations of what, where air comes out at the end of the word, where if you put your hand in front of your mouth and say, what, you can hear, you feel the air come out. You can hear that aspiration, it's called, at the end of the T. And that's different from what, where you leave your tongue held up against the roof of your mouth and you don't let the air out, what. Now, we still hear that as T, we just hear that as a different pronunciation. So, on the left, you have examples of one sound difference that creates a different word. And on the right, you have examples of one sound difference, but it doesn't create different words. Now that's important, because with minimal pairs, we know that when that one sound difference is enough to create a different word, it means your brain must be categorizing those sounds differently. Your brain must say, oh, the difference between B and L in book and look is really important. Whereas the difference between later and later isn't so important. Now, you can recognize the difference, but your brain must categorize it somehow differently. Well, it turns out that what minimal pairs are doing is they're contrasting in just one sound, but that one sound is enough to change the meaning of the word. So bit and pit are different words, even though they just have the one sound that's different. So we say that those sounds are contrastive. Now, the word contrast, remember, means to show a difference. So those sounds, B and P, make a difference in English. They're categorized differently. So when you have changes in production that change the meaning of the word, then those are phonemic changes. Whereas when you have changes in production that don't change the meaning of the word, those are allophonic changes. Phonemic differences are those differences where you've confined a minimal pair. You can say, look, look and book are different. My brain hears them as different, so those differences matter. They're contrastive. Whereas fire and fire, are not so important. I hear the difference, but it doesn't matter quite as much. What's happening is your brain has categories for certain sounds. And that category of sound is called the phoneme. So, whenever you have the different pronunciations of the letter T, whether it's the T with the air, that's what the H means. T with the air is what air comes out, or the T without the air, that's what that symbol means by the next T, what, or the flap that we saw in later, which that's what that R-looking symbol represents. Whether you have any of those pronunciations of T, your brain still hears them as, oh, a T sound. And that's because each of those pronunciations represent a different allophone of the category T, and that category is the phoneme. So the phoneme is the big category, regardless of how it's pronounced, and then each individual pronunciation that fits in that category is the allophone. So we can see this in ASL as well. In ASL, we have the hand shape A. Now, whether or not you open your thumb so that your thumb sticks out, you're going to be producing an A. Now, it's true that some words tend to have the thumb out, some words tend not to have the thumb out, but you're never going to find an instance where there's a minimal pair of two signs, and the only difference is whether the thumb is out. There's never going to be an example of that. Sure, sometimes the thumb sticks out more, sometimes the thumb's out less, but there's never a time when you say, oh, with the thumb out, it means one thing, with the thumb in, it means another. There will never be an instance of that. So that tells us that there's this category. The category is the A, and you can have it open with the thumb out or closed with the thumb in. Those are allophonic variations, variations that don't matter because they belong to the same category. Now, sure, you're going to want to do whatever the deaf community does, and you're going to want to, if they sign it with their thumb out, fine. If they sign it with thumb in, fine. Sure. Just like if you go to the South, you might pronounce fire the way my grandmother does. And if you're in another part of the world, you might pronounce it fire the way that many dialects pronounce it. But nonetheless, there will never be an instance when the position of the thumb changes the meaning of the word. Similarly, with the letter F, you have to have the index finger and the thumb touching. But the pinky finger, the ring finger, and the middle finger can either be close together or far apart. You'll never find an instance where that difference changes the meaning of a sign. Now, sure, some people will have them out more, some people have them in more, and some signs they tend to be one way or the other, but there's never going to be an instance where that change makes the sign mean something different. You'll never be able to find a minimal pair with those changes because those two changes don't change the meaning of signs. Whether the F is open or the F is closed, you still have the same category of hand shape. Your brain and the brain of a native ASL speaker sees it as the same sign, the same a member of the same category. Similarly, you can look at the location of signs in ASL. Some people will form a sign like my quite high in the middle of their chest between their breasts. Other groups of people will sign this N my a bit lower, almost on the top of their belly. Regardless of where you sign that sign, though, it's not going to change the meaning. You're never going to find signs that mean something different if they're right between between your breast versus if they're down over your breastbone. No. Even if you go a little lower toward the top of the belly, that's going to still mean the same thing. That's all the torso location. Now, if you go over and you form signs on over your heart, or at least on the non-dominant side of your torso, okay, that's a different area, and that means something different. But the signs that are right in the middle, they can be higher up or lower down. That whole area is perceived as one category. Your brain says, ah, whether it's a little higher or lower, that's one category. And so you're never going to find signs that differ just based on whether they're a little higher or a little lower around the chest area. Similarly, at the side of the head, we have signs. Signs that can be right over the temple or even lower down toward over the cheekbone. Doesn't change the meaning of the sign. So you'll see people who sign think, which is produced right at the temple, or a little lower over the cheek. Regardless, that doesn't change the meaning of the sign. That entire area, the side of the head, is the area. You'll see some allophonic variation, meaning variation that doesn't change the meaning of the sign, all in that area. If you get low enough, though, and you sign the sign think on your chin, well, then it suddenly becomes the sign for disappoint. So you can't go too far. Once you go far enough down and you become in the area at the side of the chin, then you have a different phonemic area, not allophonic, but phonemic area. Your brain says, wait a minute, that's a different category. And your brain conceptualizes those signs differently. So we can find signs that differ based on location. This is just that the difference in location has to be big enough for your brain to register the difference. So how do we know which allophone to use? If it doesn't really matter whether or not the thumb is out with the A or the thumb is in, then does that mean we can just do whatever we want? Well, that depends. Sometimes allophones vary based on free variation, which just means some dialects do it one way, some dialects do it another, some people do it one way, some people do another. There's no way to tell. And that's fine. But sometimes they vary based on complementary distribution, which means it depends on what's going on with the sign itself. So for example, if you have the A hand shape that's going to touch the body or touch the non-dominant hand, then usually you have the open A with the thumb out. Whereas if you have an A hand shape in other situations, it doesn't matter. So complementary distribution means there are rules that predict which allophone you're going to use. Still can't change the meaning of the sign, but predict which one's going to be useful there. Whereas with free variation, it means different speakers use different allophones in the same situation. But it doesn't matter because they're not different phonemes. They don't change the meaning of the signs.